Welcome, Earthlings. This is Planet Mitch, and this is episode number 5 of the brand new Planet 5D podcast. And we're going to call this one, Let's Get Scruffy.
I like it. And I'm still going to laugh every time I hear that intro.
I'm just going to walk right over you, Pamela, because I've got to get this show going. Because if I stop every time you laugh, then we'll never get anywhere. Today's guest is going to be Kanen Flowers, who's hanging out there in the background somewhere, probably wondering to himself why he got himself into the show. Are you there, Kanen?
I'm here, yes.
He's not going to talk now. He's like, oh my gosh, what is this?
No, I'm definitely here. I'm definitely capable of speaking.
Okay, good. I've started this dramatic music a couple of weeks ago, and it just seems to float Pamela's boat, which if you could see me, if this was a live video show, you would see me pretending to sing and raise my arms to the sky. And then the timpani part at the end I play, because we used to play this particular piece of music in high school, and I was on timpani, and it was just a blast because I could just beat the kajibers out of those timpani kettle drums, as some people call them. So I'm back here just going crazy, and you guys can't see it, so. Oh, my.
Well, I'm excited to have Kanen on the show, and for those of you who don't know Kanen is the creative director behind Scruffy TV, and that includes things like The Post Show, Scruffy Thinking, Scruffy Shows, Hero Punk, and honestly, an all-around brilliant man. He's familiar with so many things in the post-production world that when we were coming up with guests for the show, he was one of the very first people I thought of bringing on. So I'm excited to have you here, Kanen.
Oh, thank you. I don't know how I'm going to follow that flattering intro or that epic music. I feel like anything at this point would just be a very, you know, serious letdown of me speaking slowly and in long pauses.
Well, I'm just in love with your voice, so. It's so deep. Our other co-host, I'm sorry, Pamela, Barry Anderson, doesn't seem to be here today. He's quietly quiet. And it appears that he's on dad duty again this week, so poor Barry. His kids are great, actually, so.
I think Barry and Kanen would get along swimmingly, though, if they were in a conversation together. Just knowing Barry and a sharp and is opinionated, and I can see him and Kanen just.
Well, maybe we'll get to have a chance to meet Kanen. Kanen, where are you right now?
Are you? Where am I physically? I'm in San Francisco.
Because Barry and I are doing this tour that I mentioned briefly last week called DSLR Dynamics. And for those of you who didn't tune into last week's show, you should be flogged. If you go to dslrdynamics.com, you will find out all about our tour, and we will be in San Francisco. And maybe we can find a few minutes to sit down and chat face-to-face.
Sure. I think that it depends on the timing. So, you know, if you are familiar with the landscape that's happening right now, I'm going to be in San Francisco for another 10 days, and then I'm going to be in Portland for 5 days, and then I'm flying to Amsterdam for IBC for a week, and then I'll be in Venice for a week, and then I'm flying back to Seattle to speak at After Effects World, and then I'm going back to Portland. So I'm going to spend 5 glorious days in my new place in Portland, and then be gone for a month.
Well, we'll be in Portland and Seattle and all sorts of different towns throughout the United States. So for those of you who love Planet5D.com, make sure you check out DSLRDynamics.com. And I came up with something the other day that I sent in an email to Barry, and I don't think he laughed very much, but I'm going to call us the Dynamic Duo. Mm. Get it? DSLR Dynamics. So we're the Dynamic Duo. Yikes.
No, it's funny. Please, go ahead.
Oh, this is going swimmingly well so far. Well, I will tell people that I intend to have a lot of fun on this tour. If Barry doesn't want to have fun, he's going to be really, really sad and divorce me after the first week, because I'm gonna have lots of fun. And I hope the people that attend the show will also do the same. You can't imagine me having any fun, can you? I know.
Never.
It's difficult. So my other co-host, by the way, is Pamela Ann Barry, who is here. I didn't introduce you. You just jumped right in there.
Yeah, it's all good.
It's all good.
So you're missing one Barry, but you have the second. I think we're okay.
We've got half a Barry with us today, yes.
I consider myself whole, but, you know.
Right.
All right, so let's dive right in there. We're going to talk about a specific topic first, and then we're going to do the Meteor round, which I still don't have a good intro sound to. I started looking for some earlier, but so Pamela wants to talk about the Black Magic cinema camera.
Oh, I do.
Yes, you
do. I do. Oh, there's so much coming out. I just watched that video about that. This is how excited I am about the pocket cinema that I watched the video of the guy just opening the package, and here I am, like, excited about it. I know, I'm such a dork.
Well, actually, I just posted something on the Planet 5D HDSLR news page about, Barry's just shown up on Skype, so let me try to get him in. From the C47, do you know Jem Schofield?
Yes.
He did a really nice video this morning about the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera, and I'll make sure we'll post a link about that. He doesn't have one, but he had a guest on, and they really talked a lot about the pluses and minuses of that thing.
Now, Kanen, you shot your recent film on Black Cinema, correct? The Blackmagic.
I did. Actually, there's a, which Pamela, I know that you're probably already aware of this. There's a pretty decent article that came out in January when we shot the first half of Hereapos, because we were at the time the first feature film to ever be shot on the Blackmagic cinema camera. So we had I've joked far too many times about this, but we had two Blackmagic cinema cameras, which I always say is 20% of the functional Blackmagic cinema cameras that had been released at that time. Because there were so few cinema cameras out when we shot Hereapos, and you know, it was fidgety and it had its flaws, but it was just such an amazing camera. We shot that part of the film in ProRes because we needed the workflow, and we were very worried about a cinema DNG workflow. And then the second half, which I just wrapped on a week ago, we shot on the Blackmagic cinema camera as well, and we shot that in cinema DNG. So I'm trying to think, I have 12.8 terabytes of footage from the Blackmagic cinema camera right now.
That's, wow.
That's a lot.
And yeah. How's that? How's your workflow managing with all of that memory?
So the ProRes stuff is pretty straightforward. The Cinema DNG is, and I can get into the specifics of this, but the Cinema DNG stuff, it took me, I mean, you probably remember on Twitter, I was basically just like pleading and begging and saying, like, how do I get from Cinema DNG to not just ProRes, because ProRes, I didn't want to just go to 1080p ProRes. I wanted to go to, from Cinema DNG, which is 2.5K 12-bit, I wanted to go to 2.5K ProRes 444. And that turned out to be an incredibly long process to figure out how to do that. So Wow. It wasn't the simplest workflow that I've ever experienced.
Well, Barry,
but then again, you know, I'm used to Viper and all these other cameras, so it's not the worst.
Barry, are you there?
I'm here.
Yay, Barry's here. We started without you.
That's all right.
That's okay. Barry's recently had experience using the Blackmagic cinema camera in Chernobyl. We talked about that a little bit a week or two ago. How was the workflow for you, Barry?
I'm guessing mine's not going to be all that different. ProRes, now I guess my question for you would be is, were you liking the ProRes workflow? Were you happy with the the images you were getting and whatnot? Or did you prefer the DNG once you decided to go that route?
So I preferred the ProRes workflow because I felt like the workflow for ProRes was a little bit softer and felt a little bit more filmic. And because I don't have nothing that I do right now is destined for the theater, right? It's everything is destined for the web.
Yep.
And so I really wanted that filmic look. And 1080p ProRes looks, I mean, really beautiful on a Blackmagic cinema camera. The Cinema DNG stuff was sharper. I could see a lot more, obviously a lot more detail, but that detail, that sharpness and that detail to me felt a little bit digital and not quite as filmic. But I did find that when I converted it from Cinema DNG to ProRes, I did get a little bit of that softness back and a little bit of that film quality back. We shot in DNG because we just wanted the latitude, like everybody, right? You want the latitude to crop and then to move the image around without losing, you know, your 1080p image.
Yep.
Same reason, I agree. A lot of people shoot on the Red, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, I was a little bit skeptical when we were starting to shoot with the Blackmagic camera if I'd like it, but I think the images coming out of the camera are beautiful, and I think that if you have the desire to learn the DNG workflow, it can be awesome, but it's a commitment. It's not something you just kind of pick up and do in an evening and go, okay, I get all this. Everything's working great. It's definitely I found it to be a longer-term process that, you know, takes longer, but the results are great. But like you said, the ProRes is beautiful as well.
And actually, I heard a rumor, which, of course, Blackmagic will not substantiate because they don't tell you anything about what they're doing in the future. Actually, the irony of that is I had Dan May from Blackmagic on my podcast a week before they were about to announce the pocket camera and the professional camera, and he made zero mention of those two things coming out. It's like, well, you know, we're thinking about an MFT mount, and, you know, which everybody already knew. And then a week later, it's like, oh, by the way, pocket camera, you know, 4K camera.
Well, he's doing a good corporate thing and not filling right. The goods.
the rumor there, though, is that with the professional camera is that it's actually, they're saying it's not going to shoot Cinema DNG, that it's actually going to shoot ProRes 4K, ProRes 2K, and then ProRes 1080p, which I think would be a really interesting choice. Only because the 4K ProRes is going to be about the size of the 2.5K Cinema DNG. I mean, these files are enormous. We had a 256 gigabyte SSD, and we were shooting Cinema DNG, and we were getting 28 minutes. You know, and so we're just constantly swapping the SSDs. I don't know, Barry, if that was your experience with Cinema DNG, but boy, it felt like we went through an awful lot of hard drive space.
I was going to say, what type of hard drives do you have? We got a bunch of G-Tech drives, and I think I should have bought stock in G-Tech prior to starting my project, because same thing. I got stacks of, you know, if this was like, I feel...
That's not right. Sorry. <Stop.
laughs> Wasn't that good of a stage.
It's so epic, the G-Tech drive, that you need music for it.
But I mean, it's one of those things, like after shooting at the Blackmagic foil, I just did a project back in the 5D 3, and it was like funny. I was like shooting all day, and I'm like, oh man. And then we are backing stuff up, and you're like, oh, they're okay. I got plenty of drive space. You know, we're on the Blackmagic. It was just kind of constantly, you're like, okay, there goes 2 terabytes. There goes 3 terabytes. And it just, it's a beast. But again, that you're the people who are going to be using the DNG workflow, they're doing it for a reason that warrants that sort of, you know, need for a power hungry computer and large hard drive space. But, you know, I don't want that to deter people thinking that when you're shooting with the ProRes files, it's totally manageable. It's not, you don't have to go out and mortgage a kidney in order to pay for more hard drive space if that's all you're using it for. So I don't want to mislead people either if they're out there listening.
Right. I mean, we shot the first half, we shot in ProRes, like say it's ProRes 1080p. And on the first half of HeroPunk, we shot for 3 or 4 days, and like 3.5 days. And we had just tons of footage, you know, 50, basically we shot 50 pages, not quite 50 pages.
Wow.
And we were doing about 10 pages a day and, you know, lots of takes, 3 different cameras. We had a 3-camera shoot, and at the end of the day, we had about 2.5 terabytes.
Yeah.
And then we shot a lot less on the second half as far as not as many takes because we just didn't have the drive space. And, you know, we went through, I mean, you talk about G-Tech. I had Western Digital. And so it was just like, okay, another 3 terabyte Western Digital. We just kept going. And then we had to back them up too, right? So,
well, that's the part that people don't realize. If you're going to back them up, then suddenly your, you know, $300, $400, $600 drive purchase doubles and triples. And suddenly you're like, oh man, this gets to be a spendy workflow. But yeah, no, right. it's kind of like candy. It's like a kid in a candy store, only it's with hard drives.
Right. Well, and we demand it. I mean, because, you know, this is a, I mean, for me, it's an expensive film. For other people, it's not. I mean, our total budget for Hero Punk was projected to be $100,000. And we're going to go over that, and that's a different conversation. But, you know, so you can't afford to lose a day, right? Like every day is just tons of money for this little independent film we're doing, and you know, for our budget. And so you know, yeah, exactly. You have to make a copy, and we decided to make two copies. You know, one that we would basically have as a backup, and then one that we would have as a backup that we would take off site at the end of the day.
Yep, separate them so that they're not all in one spot. Not to get it.
And then we had it exactly. And then the third copy was we were trying to transcode to ProRes while we were on set.
Oh, that's not a good idea.
Well, we had an editor. We had an editor doing full time, 10 hours a day, doing transcoding. And you know, we thought, oh yeah, well also, you know, we'll transcode to ProRes. We'll cut a few scenes. We'll see what it looks like. No, the whole day
it's all about transcoding.
Right, a couple of MacBook Retinas just going full blast all day long.
Cool. I hope you had a deal on your editor so you weren't paying him full rate just to transcode. But
wow! But in the end, I have to say I would use a Blackmagic over probably most any other cameras at this point. I just the quality I can't surpass the quality for the price.
Yeah, I think just because it's not as prevalent, I think it's a camera that's very easy to get pigeonholed or stereotyped by, you know, a couple people who are talking about it online. So I think it's one of those things where people get a chance to work with it, you know, it's worth doing and checking it out for yourself. But I think the images are great. It's a different aesthetic than what a lot of people have been working with. But again, if you use tried and true filmmaking techniques and you're using different lenses and different filtration and different techniques, you can, it's an image that allows you to have your artistic impact on it, unlike a lot of other formats that are out there right now.
Agreed. Yeah.
And I want to say that, I mean, when we first shot in January, when we, you know, we shot on the Blackmagic, I mean, the amount of what I wouldn't say hate mail, but it was definitely anger mail that I received, you know, about why would you shoot a film on the Blackmagic? It's a piece of crap. It's this, you know, people were just so violently against it.
That's me.
You know, I don't understand.
I do. I think anytime you're doing something right, people, you know, want to go out for blood. I mean, I remember when the 5Ds first came out and everyone's like, you know, only a fool would use that camera. No, you know, blah, 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 blah. And it's just one of those things where, you know, yes, it's a tool and you can use it for some things and not for others. But I mean, really, why wouldn't you be able to use the black camera for your project? I mean, that's preposterous that someone would say, why would you even think about that? That's what it's made for. It's called a cinema camera. It's made to shoot things like, you know, episodic or even, you know, films. So I think the louder people yell at you, it usually means you're onto something right, as opposed to just following the trend of, all right, I'll get this and I'll get that. And I really don't understand why a Blackmagic gets more hate mail than Red. I mean, Red strung people out a lot longer than Blackmagic, you know, has with any of their delays. And people, you know, I think seances praising Red, and I don't hear that many people having seances to praise Blackmagic. So I don't understand the disconnect there. Seems like if you're going to hate Blackmagic, you know, Red should have been done and buried by now. But really, if they put out a tool that someone can use and it works for people, they're going to like it.
Well, it's been very polarizing. I'm sorry, Kanen, but it is really strange because it's much like the PC versus Mac wars. And I do recall
There was no war.
Yeah. Okay. I do recall, Barry, you and I having conversations where you weren't so fond of the Blackmagic, and now things are different as well.
No,
so.
I didn't understand the positioning of coming out with a camera with a small sensor. I understood the wanting the latitude and wanting the flexibility.
Right.
I just didn't see, especially from the first few pictures I saw, I wasn't convinced. But I think what the problem was, a lot of these companies do, they have technicians doing their marketing materials, and so you'll get something that a tech person does versus someone who's more of an artist. And once you get this in an artist's hand, there's a lot more that they can do with it, and I think it shows off the cameras better. So note to companies out there, you know, hire people that can make your products look better than you think they can, as opposed to what you want to do, because I think it ultimately rings more true with the potential audience base. But I mean, there's still, I mean, all these cameras. I mean, the great thing is there's not a camera right now that everybody's just universally like, that's it.
Right.
The price point, the form, all the features, everything's exactly what I want. So there is no perfect camera that works for everybody. And until that point, you know, everybody's going to have something to yell about that camera versus this camera, whether it's Blackmagic, whether it's Red, whether it's Canon, whether it's Panasonic, whatever, you name it. You know, there isn't the perfect camera, because the perfect camera for this person's, you know, $15,000, and that person's like, well, I only can spend three. And then someone spends three, but then they're complaining that it doesn't have this feature that's over there on the $10,000 camera. So right now, it's just people have to either work with what they have and be creative, or they need to, you know, get the camera that's right for their job and go to a rental house and say, I'd like to plunk down my $200 and rent the proper camera.
I love it when you get excited, Barry.
there's my 2 cents worth.
All right, let's jump into the Meteor round. What do you say?
I love it.
There's some excitement. Somebody, Barry and Kanen go, sure.
I don't know what it is. We'll do it anyway.
We did it before, Barry. You just weren't paying attention.
I was paying attention. You said you were going to maybe change it. So I don't know if it's this different same.
No, I just don't have good music to start it off. Okay. Da, da, da. Okay. All right.
Quick. Well, if you sing, more people will tune in.
Yeah. And we lost our 5 viewers right there. All right. Kanen, questions. Who is your favorite, let's say, director?
That's a tough one. So from a style perspective, it has to be David Fincher. But from a longevity perspective, it's probably, you know, the tried and true Stanley Kubrick. I mean, it's tough. Although, you know, I've been really excited about the stuff that Eli Roth has been doing lately.
And
he did this thing called Aftershock for $2 million, and it was just amazing.
What is your favorite season?
My favorite season?
Yeah.
It would be fall.
Why?
So fall has the most colors, and it I'm kind of a practicing Buddhist. Fall is a time when you get a destruction, which actually also is hopeful because it means a renewal.
Right.
And so I like to see things torn down and then see how they can come back.
I think that phrase was telling, kind of a practicing Buddhist. Not really all there, but just kind of.
Yeah, I don't like to say a practicing Buddhist because in the American culture, that means Buddhism means something different than it does in Asian cultures. And so I don't want to, I like to hedge that bet so people don't think, oh, he's a Zen Buddhist, because I'm not.
All right, fill in the blank on this one. I never get tired of blank.
Well, we have a clean tag.
Yikes.
And so I will
See, I didn't expect that
I'm
one.
I'm so glad this is audio only, because I am blushing.
I will say writing. I never get tired of writing. The thing that I'm doing a lot of right now is I'm writing screenplays, and I'm working with this guy Michael Morgan, and we're collaborating on several features, and I never get tired of it. Something about writing dialogue and putting together screenplays is very exciting to me. But it's another thing. It's that hopeful piece of it, right? It's everything is ahead of you. There's so much hope. It's really exciting.
This is a special trick question for you. If you were going to color your hair, what color would you pick?
Well, if I were going to pick a color, I would pick something that is between blue and purple.
It's a trick question, because I was watching your reports from NAB earlier, because I had no exposure to you before Pamela turned me on to you. So I was watching those and I thought, that's some interesting hair.
Yeah. So do you know the story behind that?
No, I don't.
Okay. So I'll tell it very quickly. Autodesk came out with something called Fix It in Post, which was a little teaser by Jeremy Hunt to try and show off what you could do with Autodesk. And I, at the same time, had come out with something that was shot on the 5D, and it was called The Dark Knight Descends. And so it was this parody of The Dark Knight Rises. And so I, on Twitter, said, because this is when everybody was making their icons green to support visual effects.
Right.
And I said, I tell you what, if this thing gets more views than Autodesk's, you know, corporate video, Fix It in Post, then I will give my, I will cut my hair into a mohawk. And I said, and if I get over 100,000 views by the time I go to the editor's retreat, I will dye that mohawk green to support the visual effects industry. And so, I mean, I won, but I lost, right? Like we got over 100,000 views. And so I dyed, I had a green mohawk. I presented at the editor's retreat with a green mohawk.
That's awesome. Although when I saw the videos, it was kind of green in the front and purple in the middle.
So then Teresa, which who's my assistant, she dyed her hair pink just because she thought it was fun to dye hair. And so when we went to NAB, she said, you know, green, you know, you already did the green. So, but you still have a mohawk. So why don't you do it purple or do it blue? And I was like, what about green, blue, and purple? So it has this kind of graduated. It is currently short and not a mohawk.
Right? Aw, boo.
I know. I mean, I didn't do it. I mean, but the thing is, I did it as a bet, and I just, you know, I'm 105 years old. I don't need to be walking around with a green mohawk.
I don't know. For those of you who come to the DSLR Dynamics Tour, I'm going to be making a little bit of fun of Barry and his hair, so you guys can look forward to that.
I'm going to cut it off, Mitch. I'm going to steal your thunder, and I'm going to come bald.
Oh, okay. Well, then I'll shave my head if you'll do it.
I think everybody would leave the room, so maybe we shouldn't do that.
Well, I did my hair like Barry's hair. Barry likes to get his hair straight up in front because he's constantly running his fingers through it. And I took a picture of myself after I got out of the shower when my hair was wet, and I did the sticking it straight up thing. And I showed the picture to my wife, and she says, that looks like you're being booked for some kind of criminal act. Oh, great. So anyway. Well,
I know that we've just lost our clean tag, and so next week we can really say whatever we want.
We did? I didn't
say. Yeah.
Did I?
you're not paying attention to what you're saying. It's okay.
Okay.
I just would like to point out that I am not the person who violated the clean tag on this show.
All right, so that wraps up the Meteor round.
So, Kanen, now we've been discussing this obviously with the Black Camera, Black Cinema Camera, but you have been working on Hereapos and you just wrapped up. And I want to know more about the whole workflow and how you're incorporating Hereapos into Scruffy TV and how you have your editors worldwide. I want to know more about that, and because it's so fascinating.
Well, that's an interesting open-ended question. I'll try and answer as best I can. And obviously I'm not going to do a very good job of being thorough, but I'll do my best. So in 2012, and Pamela, you and I have talked about this with, to some extent, which is in 2012, I made a choice, which is I said, I'm going to start releasing original content on the internet, whether it be a spoof or something that we wrote, but that's totally original. But everything is completely, you know, written by us, original in that sense, show. And I want to try and do it on green screen, and I want to try and get this production workflow and this post-production workflow together where I can basically assemble a group of people, shoot something for a day or 2 days or a week, and then I can put it on hard drives, distribute it around the world to editors and visual effects folks and audio folks, and we can have a completely 100% distributed pipeline where we're sharing drives, and then we're sharing project files on Dropbox, and basically, you know, it's this virtual company or this virtual team that's global.
Which is
and
fascinating.
Oh, thank you. That took, to be honest, that took a lot longer than I thought it would take. I thought in 2012 I'd do a few shows. You know, I'd do the Scruffy show, and I would do, you know, a few little pieces here and there, and then we would end up, you know, 6 months later we would have this beautiful production and post-production pipeline, and we would be shooting Hereapos, which was sort of the goal from the beginning, and everything would be groovy. But what happened was it took all of 2012, and it was a lot more time and money and energy and problems and all of these things than I ever imagined it being. And then by 2013, we were in a position where we were actually able to, I think, kind of start realizing the vision. So if you look at 2013, what you see is you know, the first thing we released in 2013 is The Dark Knight Descends, which is a parody of The Dark Knight Rises. And that followed our production workflow sort of, and our post workflow sort of. And then finally, a couple of months ago, or it's not quite a couple of months ago at this point, I think, we released Flight Club, which is a parody of Fight Club. It's kind of thinky, but it was 100% shot on green screen, and it was shot with a Canon 5D, a Canon 60D, and a Canon T3i, all on green screen. And then it was all composited using the Adobe Creative Cloud and Red Giant. And that was it. That is now our workflow, which is an all Adobe Creative Cloud and Red Giant workflow with Dropbox for project files, with hard drives that we send out, where those hard drives actually have, basically they're clones of each other, right? So we have a master hard drive, and then we use Super Duper or Carbon Copy Cloner to create an exact copy of it. And then we ship that out. And then we have the project files on Dropbox. And what's really cool about that is we have a master project file. And then we've dynamically linked After Effects comps into that. And so at any given time, we can have a master Premiere Pro project file. And we can have audition sessions and After Effects files and all of these things all on Dropbox, all pointing to our, quote, local drive, right, which is local to each of us. And people can be working on, you know, 20 people can work on the same project at the same time. And that was the workflow for Flight Club. And I think Adobe was pleased enough with that that they actually wrote, a really nice article. And then I'm on the 22nd, which is tomorrow as we record this, I'm actually doing an Adobe Ask a Pro session to talk about that particular workflow.
Cool.
It's funny, too, because when we did that workflow, I didn't think that we were going to be so far out in the weeds. Right, I thought, well, you know, I'm sure lots of people are doing this, but it turns out lots of people weren't doing it, which was very surprising to me.
Don't some of the bigger studios do that kind of stuff, though?
My experience was that I thought that was true, but then when I started asking around, it turns out that that's just not
really.
There's a lot of drives being shipped around. There's a lot of high-end software. There's a lot of like Avid has this technology, which for some reason I want to call Anywhere, but that's Adobe's version. You know, where you can basically you can log in with your Avid to shared storage in the cloud, and you can share assets and all that. But that starts at $100,000.
Wow!
And so nobody really has this what I consider to be a truly independent film workflow where you're leveraging Dropbox and copied drives and those sort of things. And what I found with the studios is that most people either work, they're geographically adjacent to one another, right? Like they're sitting across from each other.
Right.
Or they send a small piece of what they want done to someone who does compositing or visual effects. But there's not really a situation where you get all the assets and you're free to work on any of them, right? It's always, you get this little piece, you get these DPX files of just this one scene, and then you work on that. And then you send that, and then you just literally mail back, you FedEx back the results.
So it sounds like you've got a great business opportunity in front of you.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I thought that might be the case, but, you know, then I realized, like, I just want to tell stories and make films. I don't want to get in the business of trying to do workflow automation.
Yeah, understand.
So hopefully I can just tell people what I'm doing, and they can either say, that's crazy, or I agree, and then they can do it too. You know, I can share what I know without, I mean, you know, how it is, right? I can either develop plugins or make movies, and I chose to make movies.
The artist comes out every time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and speaking of movies, now I watched Flight Club before it was completely finished, and you watched me watch it. And
that sounds weird.
Well, he was
clean tag.
But after watching it, and of course, I had this internal battle of what did I just watch, and what is it making me feel like? And yet, I couldn't turn away from it. It was so, it kept me focused throughout the whole movie, that by the end, I just sat there and was like, wow, that was so interesting, and yet I want to see more, and I don't know why. And I think that's exactly what you wanted, because it was told in such a way that honestly I haven't seen before, and so thank you for making that and showing that to the world. And I'm glad that you're making more of that type of art.
Oh, thank you. You know, it's interesting too, because you're right. You had the exact reaction that I wanted from people, which is I wanted people to watch it. I wanted them to stick with it, but I also wanted them to watch it. And at the end, decide that either they didn't like it, or there was something about it that made them uneasy, or there was something about it that they liked, but they weren't sure what it was. I mean, I was trying to build, you know, David Lynch I'm a big fan of David Lynch, and Lost Highway to me is a great film, because Lost Highway is one of those films that you either like it or you hate it, or you just don't know how the heck you feel about it. And I wanted to kind of recreate that. And I felt that way when I first saw Fight Club, the movie, not the parody that I did, but when I first saw Fight Club, I realized I was with a group of my friends and we went out for a drink afterwards. And I realized that everyone had their opinions. I liked it. I didn't like it, whatever. But everyone had also that same sort of visceral reaction, which was like, what the hell just happened to me?
Yeah.
Like they felt kind of beat up, right?
Yes.
And so I wanted to recreate that. I wanted to recreate the feeling that when you watch something that you felt a little beat up by it, like you weren't sure what just happened to you.
Which
and that turns
exactly
out, as
happened.
You know, to be kind of difficult.
Yeah.
Well, I actually got to watch part of that this morning when I was learning more about you. And I unfortunately did not watch the whole thing, but I can verify that that's the feeling I felt. I wanted to watch the rest of it, but I knew I needed to do some more research about you. So I stopped and I want to go back to it, but I was a little uncomfortable with it, just so you know.
Excellent. I think it's fantastic. And so The Dark Knight, let's talk about the two things that we've released this year. So The Dark Knight Descends, and you can tell one was kind of experimental and one was kind of jokey. So The Dark Knight Descends was the kind of jokey thing, right? It's like, it's meant to be a joke. It's a little bit, everything we do is a little bit finky. Like we're not doing fart jokes, right? We're trying to do something that people can laugh at because it's intellectually interesting or because it touches some part of them. It's a sort of thinking person's comedy, right? And so The Dark Knight Descends is, like, the joke is that the villain is called Banter instead of Bane. And because all he does is just sit around and talk, like, I will kill you. You will die. Eventually, I will get to a place where I will beat you up, you know. And then Catwoman in the actual Dark Knight Rises was just an afterthought. She just walked by and then kicked somebody in the face and was done. I mean, she just wasn't really a character. She was so one-dimensional. And so we had a scene where Catwoman inexplicably at the end of a scene just walks by, kicks somebody in the face and keeps going. And that's it. That is the only appearance of Catwoman. And so that one, which wasn't meant to make you uncomfortable and was just meant to just really poke fun at what a colossal, from a story perspective, what a colossal disaster I thought The Dark Knight Rises was, you know, and how it was sort of the promise of the first two Dark Knights sort of, you know, kind of came unglued or unraveled. And that has, between Vimeo and iTunes and YouTube, that has about 1.5 million views.
Wow, awesome.
Whereas Flight Club, which was, again, meant to kind of beat you up and make you feel uneasy, has, in the same period of time, well, not quite the same period of time, but it has about 120,000 views. But you know, I don't do it for, I'm not out there like, oh, you know, I want a million views. I do these things because I figure if there are 10,000 people in the world that have the same sense of humor or same sensibility that I do, that's my audience, right? That whole like Purple Cow, Seth Godin idea or Malcolm Gladwell idea that you really only need 10,000 fans to be successful.
Right.
Everything we do, we target for the 10,000 people who are like us, who like comic books and like superheroes and like cyberpunk and read, you know, Neuromancer by William Gibson and read Snow Crash. And, you know, those are the people that we're sort of targeting. And so I always considered a massive success if I hit what I consider to be that tiny little sliver of a target audience that I'm aiming for.
You also have your own podcast, which is highly successful, by the way.
Oh.
Oh, I also had not been exposed to that before today, and I listened to the most recent episode.
The Zach Arnold, Scott Simmons one?
Yes. fascinating conversation, especially so this is called That Post Show, just for you people out there trying to figure out which podcast we're talking about, and we'll have a link to that in the show notes. The story in there about, I think it was Zach, who is editing a full-length feature film in Mandarin without understanding Mandarin in the slightest. Absolutely fascinating story.
Yeah, and we should point out that Zach is not some random guy. Zach is the editor of Burn Notice.
Right, right.
Which is extremely successful. This is the last season that just wrapped, but it's an extremely successful television series. You know, I would consider him an A-list editor, right? Before that, he did the Bannon Way. Extremely talented guy. Yeah, and he does this Chinese feature film without speaking a word of it. And now after the fact, of course, he's learning Chinese and he's going to the premiere and these kind of things. But yeah, that was a fascinating story. And the sort of weirdly self-referential part of that story that made me personally super happy was he decided to do that because he was inspired by an episode of That Post Show that he heard between myself and John Burkhart, where we talked about trying to make a feature film in Thailand. And so it was this kind of weird thing where somebody who was on the show had heard another show and was inspired enough to do a foreign language film. So that was probably one of the best feelings I've had in a very long time, is realizing that I had an impact on somebody, and that impact was, you know, very positive for their life.
Well, and that goes back to reaching those fans who really connect with you, you know, that smaller group of people, because that's what makes a difference.
Yeah, I think so. Without getting mushy, because I could cry about this. I mean, tears of joy, right? I have so much respect for Zach, and even before he was ever on the show, I talked about how one of my favorite sort of breakaway success stories was a show called The Bannon Way, which was this low budget, extremely well edited feature film that actually became successful and was distributed by Sony on crackle.com, and then now you can get it in Netflix. You can see it on Netflix and you can get it on iTunes. But it was this weird runaway, you know, $50,000, you know, $100,000 at the most, you know, success. And it was designed as a 12-part web series that became a full-length feature, which was really cool.
What I like about listening to your podcast is it allows me to watch any show and see it completely different from an editor's perspective. And that's what I've gained a lot from listening to your podcast, is now and being able to view any show as an editor's eye enables me to be a better editor. And I think that's the best thing that I've gotten out of listening to your podcast.
Well, I humbly thank you.
Well, I'm going to have to start listening to these a lot more, although I don't have the drive time that you guys were talking about in that recent episode, because I do work from home and I don't get to go in the car. My only podcast time for listening is when I'm mowing the lawn, which is only once a week for 45 minutes, so I don't get much in. I actually tried listening to podcasts in the shower, but that's not working very well either. But that's all another story.
Well, yeah, thank you. I mean, I feel, you know, Pamela said successful or popular. I forget the very flattering term that she used, because it's hard to take a compliment, right? We're all used to being sort of behind the scenes, and so compliments aren't something we're very good at accepting. But I always joke on the show that, you know, I have one of the most popular podcasts in post-production, which is like saying I have the fanciest hut in a third world country. You know, it's such a very small group of people. But the thing that's great about that, and the thing that it's afforded me that I think has been fabulous, is it has afforded me an opportunity for people like Zach Arnold or Alan Bell, who's the the editor of 500 Days of Summer, Amazing Spider-Man, and The Hunger Games. You know, it's afforded me an opportunity to get them on the show, and so that has been, you know, that has been amazing. And then I've had. One of the things that's happened to me that I feel truly blessed by is one of my favorite movies. In fact, you know, one of the movies that really changed my entire worldview about my sense of humor, about comedy, about how all of filmmaking works, you know, was a movie called Heathers, right? Because it showed me it doesn't have to be Molly Ringwald and John Hughes and and all of these different things, you can actually have a dark sense of humor. And that was edited by a guy named Norman Holland. And Norman Holland has been a guest on my show many times. But when I first had Norman on the show, it was just, it was sort of, you know, I don't get starry-eyed about almost anyone. But, you know, having someone like that who you think, man, at the time that he edited Heather's, nothing even remotely existed like that. It was so groundbreaking as a film.
Okay, I've so just that's been to amazing. My list to watch. All right, Heather's.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, definitely.
It's just amazing, and you gotta put it in context too. You have to go back and watch Heather's, knowing that like 16 Candles and, you know, all of these John Hughes films, The Breakfast Club, you know,
right.
were super popular at the time. They were the standard. They were the norm. And then Heather's comes out and they talk about, you know, drinking Drano and Ick Luga bullets. And like, there's a scene where this father is like, I love my dead gay son. And you're just like, what am I watching? How is this possible that this amazing thing is in front of me? You know? So it was just, yeah, it was fantastic. And, you know, there are two other movies that I had a similar experience about. One of them is Fight Club, obviously. And at the same time, Fight Club and The Matrix came out, and those were two really amazing movies. And then even more recently, The Wrestler, the Mickey Rourke film. You know, these are films where you go, all right, that's it. You guys are, you know, you get it. You guys are making movies. I don't know what the rest of us are doing, but you guys are making movies.
Nice. I'd like to add a fourth one in there. I think Grown Ups 2 is really a peak of modern film as well. So just in case people think that it's just the art house films that are killing it these days.
Grown Ups 2.
I haven't seen that one.
I haven't either.
I'm obviously talking to too nerdy of a group. No, it's the horrible Adam Sandler sequel.
Yeah.
Where all of his friends get together. Yeah, no, it's not very good.
So you're making a joke. Okay.
Yeah, no, I thought it was self-evident because it was Grown Ups 2, but apparently not. Well, so.
Barry, I never always 100% know how serious or teasing you are. So,
well, Adam Sandler, he's done some fine movies, but I still don't think he'd be in the upper echelon of capable. Well, he's not technically a filmmaker, but his movies aren't anywhere near things like Fight Club or The Matrix, unfortunately.
How did we go from Heather's to Adam Sandler?
Barry's trying to make a joke. That's why.
Although Adam Sandler was in Punch Drunk Love, which is
great.
True.
Definitely fantastic. No,
he's done some great work. Just in general, though, usually it's the, you know, he's made his fortune off of his comedy, like it or not.
TNA.
And
yeah. Oh, by the way, Kanen, I don't know if you've noticed this, but your next episode will be episode 100.
The next episode of
that podcast show.
Yeah, that post show.
I did not know that.
There are 99 episodes listed in this in iTunes.
So
you're going to have to do something special.
I know. I've already recorded it. I'll have to tell. I'll have to tell my editor during the intro to say this is episode 100. It's weird. I consider, you know, numbering the episode kind of artificial because I think
that's
the episodes sort of stand on their own. Well, it's for my show. I mean, other people can do whatever they want, right or wrong. But for my show, that's also a joke, Barry. But for my show, I just feel like each show is sort of self-contained in a way where I think numbering it isn't really fair to the people on the show because each show is so much in its own universe. And I do that on purpose.
That's so Buddhist.
Mm.
No, I'm sorry. Another bad joke.
That's the name of my new Netflix
today.
Original series is That's So Buddhist.
It would probably work as well.
Well, before that, we were really bouncing around Oh My Buddha, which didn't test well with audiences because, you know.
Wow. Oh, I don't know.
And you have to do it in that morning voice that you started with earlier today.
That's right. Hello and welcome to Oh My Buddha.
I don't know where to go now. Good grief.
That's right.
So what's the next big project you're working on?
Well, so Hereapunk is really the thing that's going to eat up a tremendous amount of my time because, you know, as I mentioned, it's over 12 terabytes of footage. And, you know, we're doing, I mean, it's so funny just even getting down to the place where you're, you know, you're labeling and syncing audio and just getting the files into a place where you can hand it off to editors. I mean, that's a lot of work. I mean, people don't realize just the amount of work that has to be done for asset management. I'm sure Barry, you're experiencing this a similar thing. It's just asset management is a long road. And so we're doing that, but I'm really struggling with, you know, because I am moving to Portland and I just shot the last thing that I'll ever shoot in San Francisco. And so I'm struggling with what is my next project? And I've shot something that's making fun of Burn Notice. It's a 10-minute short called Burn Novice. It's about an incompetent spy. And I was fortunate, extraordinarily fortunate to make friends with and have him agree to edit it. And so Zach Arnold, who is no longer on Burn Notice, is the editor of Burn Novice. So I got the Burn Notice editor to edit Burn Novice, which is for me one of those also like home runs. Like, I can't believe this happened. It's a little weird insider baseball, but it's kind of fun. And we've already shot that, and then we shot something else called Ferociously Cute, which is it's about a little boy who makes a wish that his teddy bear comes to life, and it does. And then as it gets older, it goes through puberty and becomes a monster and kills him, his family, the boss, the neighbor's dog, and half the people down the street.
Jeez.
And so we're doing post-production on Burn Novice and Ferociously Cute. And then we shot the first episode of something called The Z Event, or for Canadian and English listeners, The Z Event, which is a parallel universe. It's creatures in a parallel universe who are, they have to consume other people to survive, and they're hyper intelligent. They've perfected trans-dimensional travel, and they go between worlds, consuming these worlds. But if they don't keep consuming people, then they revert back to kind of a zombie state where they're just mindless. And so they've basically consumed their entire world, and then they're moving between worlds. And so that's called The Z Event. And I shot the pilot of that. And then I'm working on an original movie. So that's an original movie. And then I'm working on another original movie called String Theory, which is about a little girl traveling through time to find her estranged father.
How do you find time to do all this?
Well, you know, as I said, I mean, I consider myself a filmmaker and a storyteller. And the thing for me is, if I'm not doing that, so Stu Redwine said it best. He said, when you make a movie, it's like you're coming up for air and you breathe. And then when you're not making a movie, it's like you're underwater holding your breath.
Huh.
And the question is, how long can you be underwater holding your breath before you have to come up for air? And as I get older, for me, that time underwater becomes less and less, and I need to spend much more time coming up for air.
That's very accurate. That's exactly how I'm feeling, actually.
You should sell T-shirts. You can finance your next film off that.
We would have to summarize
this
into something.
This is not
short,
a joke. That's you're good. No, have the whole thing. Fine. It's a winning business model. Make you shoot more.
Which comes to an interesting question. I mean, you've just rattled off four or five different projects there. How are you coming up with funding?
So I'm very lucky, again, in that I am. So that post show is financed through sponsorship, and we basically have sponsors lined up, and we have sponsors. We are over sponsored right now.
Well, we need to borrow a few of those if we could, please.
Well, sure.
I'm working on it.
meaning we have sponsors through the end of the year, and we have other people who are willing to be sponsors whenever a slot opens up. And so some of the money comes from that, and then some of the money comes from me doing things like with Flight Club. I went to Red Giant Software and I said, hey, I'm going to shoot this thing called Flight Club, and it could be sponsored by Red Giant. And it's going to cost $5,000 or $10,000. And And they're like, well, you know, maybe software, you know, maybe. And so we just work out these deals where, you know, where these shows are sponsored by different people. And so it, that funds it in some ways. And then for Hereapos, the budget of Hereapos is $100,000. And I launched a Kickstarter campaign to raise $25,000 of that because I didn't want to ask the community for all the money because I didn't think that that was, I don't know, for some reason it didn't feel right. But I wanted to ask for a part of the money. And so my idea was that Kickstarter would put in, you know, 25 of the $100,000 budget, and that would give people an opportunity to see, you know, they would get storyboards and all of these other things. And so, I mean, I guess the short answer is that we raise money in a lot of different ways for these projects, but we have been successful enough to have a group of people doing edits and to continue to do new projects. So I feel very fortunate there. And then the other short part of it is, you know, I speak at conferences and I personally do things that also generate some of the money as right. well. So it's not just
millions
it's not
of
one
dollars.
Place, right? It's not just one, you know, one place. Like every filmmaker, we raise money where we can. And then we use whatever money we raise to set our budget. And then, you know, we try not to spend more than we're bringing in.
And you know that you always have the backup of a second kidney if you really need it.
That's true. That's true.
It's good to know.
Yes.
No, but I think this is great for people to hear because I think everybody, you know, everybody thinks everybody else on the other side has it easy. And some people do have it easier than others. But, you know, like you said, if you raise X amount of dollars, whether it's $5,000, $10,000, $100,000, you're finding projects then you can make for that dollar amount and get it out there in the world and then move on to the next one. And I think that's what people need to do is find a way to do more, not wait to do less.
Yeah, and I think a great example of that is Hereapos, which is it's shot 100% on green screen. You know, we shot Hereapos on an 1,100 square foot green screen, one of those wraparound Sykes that was painted green, floor to ceiling, you know. And my choice would never have been to shoot it on green screen. That was not what I wanted to do. But we had familiarity with Flight Club and Dark Knight and other stuff we're doing. We had familiarity with comping in 3D models and all these things. And so, and I looked at shooting it in, because Hereapos takes place in San Francisco in 2042. And so I thought, well, that's already one thing where I'm going to have to distress buildings and do all this other work. But not just that, the cost of shooting it in practical locations and the time, right? So it would have taken 5 times longer and would have cost 10 times as much. And so that was a budgetary issue for us is, we knew there was no way we could make the film without making huge sacrifices about where we shot it. And so we chose to shoot it on green screen. And we did crazy tracking markers. And if you've looked at any of the stills that we've put out from the set, I mean, they're insane. I mean, yeah. it scares me to my core to think about the amount of post-production work we have on that.
While we're there, most people listening have probably not seen your site. Would you tell us where those stills are?
So if you go to scruffy.tv, you will find links to my first feature film, Jake Forgotten, which is, fingers crossed, going to actually be available online this year. And then you'll find links to Hereapos and links to all the other stuff we're doing, that post show, the Scruffy shows, all of those different things. And I think right now, if you go to scruffy.tv, on the front page is you can watch Flight Club. Because we try and put our most recent video on the front page. And then we have a link to the team so you can see who the distributed team is that I talked about. You know, we don't have two people up, which is really, I need to get on them about this. We don't have Paul Del Vecchio, who's an award-winning filmmaker and director and cinematographer from Long Island. He's not on the team page, even though he shot most of what we're doing. He was the camera guy and even directed a few things. And then we don't have Patrick Johnson, who is a filmmaker from Dallas, Texas. We don't have him on the team page, even though those are the two guys that actually shot. I mean, I directed Hereapos, but they directed some of it and shot all of it. So, you know, we're still working out the details there.
we could also all find your links to following you on Twitter and that sort of thing as well.
That's right. Yeah, Instagram. All that stuff.
Well, that's awesome. I'm so glad you were able to join us today. You're a fascinating person, which just made me giddy about having you on today.
Thank you very much. What?
Oh, yeah, I appreciate that. Thanks for having me on. You guys have been super fun to talk to. Barry, I'm sorry that you both came in late and then we didn't get nearly enough time to talk. You sound very interesting.
Well, yeah, well, I'm going to follow up with you offline and we can throw away bad jokes. And I'd love to hear what you're doing. And my guess is I work with Andrew Cohen, who's a part of your team and stuff. I'm sure that our worlds will eventually ebb closer and closer together. So we can see if there's ways that we can do or promote each other on the stuff that we're doing. So sounds cool.
Yeah, it sounds fun. I think, you know, as I've said many times on my own show, you know, we're all in this lifeboat together, right? And so it's really crappy of one of us to say your side of the lifeboat is leaking when we're, you know, when we're all trying to do the same thing.
Some great quotes out of this show.
Although keep telling you, t-shirts, man, t-shirts.
T-shirts. Your side of the lifeboat is leaking. That's my next t-shirt.
I guarantee everybody that sees you on the road will be like, what does that mean? It would be an instant conversation starter.
All right. Well, let's wrap this sucker up. I want to thank everybody for tuning in. And we hope that you will tell all of your friends and neighbors about this wonderful show. And we are on iTunes. If you jump over to iTunes and just do a simple search for Planet 5D, you will find the podcast. And there are two versions there. One of them is the video version, which I am uploading to YouTube to try to get some additional attention over there, which really isn't video because we're not recording video, but we fake it into a video by putting some wonderful photographs that I've shot throughout my history. But the audio version is still broken. For those of you who may have tried to look at that, I'm really irritated with the whole XML podcast thing and iTunes. And the original, you don't need to know all the details, but I can't get the people that wrote the original XML to fix it because, quite frankly, it's just broken. And it quit showing shows that I had done from back in 2012, and I know about it, but I'm trying to get it fixed. But we do appreciate it if you tell your friends and neighbors. If you have any questions, we would love to be able to answer them on future shows, so send those in to me at planetmitch@planet5d.com. And next week, Pamela, you know who we're going to have on?
Yes, next week we have a producer, director, editor. His name is Christian Surge. He edits and produces stuff for the Outdoor Channel, and he puts on big concert events with you know, people like Lone Star and things like that. And he just finished doing a welcome home celebration out in D.C., a live broadcast celebrating all the troops coming home. So it'll be a good one.
Sounds like it. And I do want to follow up with you people who have been watching, listening to all the shows. A couple of weeks ago, I mentioned a super secret person that we're hoping to have on the show, and almost all of the details are worked out, but I still can't tell you who that is because I don't want to tell you who it is until we get the show recorded, because then if we don't get it done, then I'll feel like a real fool. Okay. But I think people are going to be really excited about this guy because he's never, ever, ever been heard speaking anywhere in the world. So that'll be really cool. Anyway, this is Planet Mitch saying over and out.
I think we need to do a little more all-weather testing. We've had a couple of cardiac arrests down here, too.
We got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again, thanks.
That was definitely an E-ticket.
Roger, 0G, and I feel fine.
Returning him safely to the Earth.